What is up, Great Whale Investing? Alex here. We're going to be talking today about the formats, okay? Where do your reserve list cards see play? Okay, what are the different formats? Here we go. We got them right here. We got EDH, we got Legacy, Vintage, Pre-Modern, and Old School. Okay, these are the five major formats where your reserve list cards will see play. Now, there's a couple honorable mentions. I want to mention Cube, my favorite format. Cube drafting is where you build your own custom set of cards and people draft from them. Now, to have powerful cubes, you're going to want to put some reserve list cards in there, whether they're Power 9 and Dual Lands or cards like Deranged Hermit and Recurring Nightmare, stuff like that. So, there you have it. That is one of the honorable mentions. Another one I wanted to mention was Canadian Highlander. Canadian Highlander is a 100-card singleton format. And it has legality from vintage of the whole vintage card pool, pretty much every card in Magic besides like Chaos Orb and stuff. So a lot of reserve list cards are legal, like Black Lotus and Friends, but there's a point system. You can only bid like 10 points in your deck. So you can put like a Mox or two, or like a Black Lotus and an Intuition in your deck. So you really aren't going to need to buy too many reserve list cards for that. You will probably need dual lands and stuff, but yeah, so that's another form, but the Cube and Canadian Highlander are fringe, more fringe formats when it comes to those, so they don't aren't like huge drivers of reserve list prices. But we're gonna talk about the biggest driver of reserve list prices, and that is EDH. Okay, EDH is the largest format in Magic, the one that the most people play. They play it casually, they can play it somewhat competitively, as far as like, you know, their philosophy goes, more than there being tournaments for it, let's say. But yeah, EDH is one of the driving forces in Magic. It's huge. It's huge. They Wizards produces products for it every single year, and they design cards in their standard and, you know, supplementary products just for Commander. It's crazy, honestly. I think we crossed the 1,000 legendary creature threshold this year or last year. Just over 1,000 different legendary creatures in Magic, and it's no surprise because EDH is huge. So a lot of the biggest, most expensive reserve list cards, looking at cards like Black Lotus, Time Walk, you know, the Mox, and all those cards are not legal in EDH because of their cost, most likely. When the format was created, they didn't want it to be like a gatekeeping thing, like, oh, if you don't have Mox Emerald, your green deck is just going to be worse. Turns out that nowadays there are still many high-end reserve list cards that are legal in the format. A card like Time Twister, for instance. Time Twister was always the laughing stock of the Power 9. It was always the least most valuable until EDH became popularized, and it is the only piece of Power 9 legal in EDH. Because of that, Time Twister is the second most expensive of the Power 9, right behind Lotus. It's more than Recall, Time Walk, all the Moxen. Crazy. So be careful who you make fun of in high school. So yeah, so EDH still has a lot of higher end reserve list cards, but it also has a lot of middle of the ground reserve list cards like Grim Monolith, Power Artifact, Transmute Artifact, Opalescence, Serra's Sanctum, Palancron, Memory Jar. A lot of these cards don't see play in other formats, just EDH, but they're good in EDH, and because of that, you know, people desire those cards. You can look at a card like Survival of the Fittest too, just a great EDH staple for green, and people have to fork over serious money to add those cards to their deck. So yeah, the reserve list is hugely is a huge factor in EDH because a lot of the most powerful cards. Look at Gilded Drake. Gilded Drake, man. I wish I bought some $60 Gilded Drakes, but they are huge in the format. It's like one of the best blue cards printed, and it's just, you know, hundreds and hundreds of dollars now because it's just primarily used in EDH. So if you're ever looking at purchasing certain reserve list cards, you can go on EDH Rec and just look at, like, it shows you charts and for particular cards and shows you like how often they're used, what their inclusion rate is, what decks it sees playing. Get a good feel for like how popular that card is in the format. So up next is Legacy. Okay, Legacy is a format that has had, you know, a bumpy ride of support from Wizards and other companies throughout its lifetime. You know, at one point it was very popular, and nowadays, because of the price of the cards, it's kind of dwindled in popularity. Legacy doesn't have a huge number of reserve list cards that see play in the format, but the big one are dual lands, and you need multiple copies. So you're looking at needing three volcanics, three tropicals, a few badlands, a few underground seas. It adds up quick, okay? And dual lands are just expensive, and they're hard to get, they're hard to find, they're just, you know, the cream of the crop in Legacy. There's some other fringe reserve list cards that see play. Mox Diamonds, he's playing lands. There's Metalworker and stuff see play in like these weird archetypes, Candelabra, Tauanos. You know, there's always a few like outlier reserve list cards, but the primary one that sees play is our dual lands. And, you know, if you want to play elves, you need four Gaea's Cradles. Ouch. So the price of Legacy now is like the price of Vintage when I started playing. So a lot of people have been priced out of the format. And because of that, its popularity has dwindled. That being said, it's a great format. It's a lot of fun. And if you can afford it, you know, save up towards it. Save up one dual land at a time and you can build a Legacy deck. Up next, we have Vintage. Okay, Vintage is big boy club. Okay, Vintage is the format that has some of the most expensive decks in the game. And you're looking at, you know, anywhere from $30,000 to $60,000 for one Vintage deck. And you need Black Lotus and Ancestral Recall and the Power Nine and a few dual lands, of course. And, you know, you're off to the races. It's expensive format. Doesn't have a lot of support in paper. More in Modo because the cards are cheap. But it doesn't have a lot of support because it's just, it's out of people's price range. You can buy like a new car, like a good car, you know, for the price of a Vintage deck. And it's definitely a labor of love if you intend to, you know, start from scratch on a Vintage deck. By the time you start saving up money, depending how slow you do it, the cards will just be outpacing you in price. A lot of store of value and very high-end cards are in that format. So people are buying Black Lotuses, not just because they play Vintage, because they just want to collect and hold on to the cards. So you're looking at, there are not enough, might not be a lot of Vintage players, but the prices of the cards in Vintage, you're looking at the Power Nine, you're looking at Mishra's Workshop, Bazaar of Baghdad, Tabernacle of Pendril Veil. These cards go up in price because people just want to invest in them. They might not play a single game of Vintage for as long as they live, but they just want the cards. So again, the Vintage format isn't really a driver of the price necessarily, although you do need four Bazaars or four Workshops respectively. But again, those are derived from their value and their long-term profitability. If you look at the charts, they're very in favor of those. Here's a format a lot of people might not have heard of. It's called Pre-Modern. Pre-Modern ends with Scourge and starts with Ice Age. So it's everything before Modern, that started in 8th edition, and everything after Old School that ends in like Fallen Empires usually. So it's, you know, a few years of Magic's cool, most fun cards. You know, it's pretty much stuff that's in the old border frame. As a result, there are quite a few reserveless cards that see play in the format. Now, before I scare you away, the format is very budget friendly. It's just there are a couple of decks you're going to need reserveless cards. For instance, you want to play Elves, four Gaea's Cradles. If you want to play some kind of like land tax deck, you're going to need four Mox Diamonds. You know, there's some decks that require Opalescence or Replenish. Some decks require Survival of the Fittest or Recurring Nightmare, Deranged Hermit. There's just, so this format has a few sprinklings of reserve list cards. This format hasn't really spiked the price of a lot of them, but cards like Mastercore or Morphling have certainly gone up in, you know, with perspective to this format. In particular, they don't even see much play in EDH. So the driver of that format would definitely be Pre-Modern. Pre-Modern is also responsible for spiking a lot of the old border foil prices. You look at cards like Pernicious Deeds, Decree of Justice, Siege Giant Commander. If you look at these foil prices, their multipliers are crazy because of they're getting snatched up one at a time from the pre-modern market. Last but not least, let's talk about Old School. Okay, Old School is akin to Vintage in the fact that you need the Power Nine, so you're looking at $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 base cost for the deck. Generally, depending on how much power you need. You can play some decks that only play one Mox or two, especially if they're non-blue. Like, you don't need the blue power. But, I mean, you're still looking at ridiculous amounts of money, five figures at the very least, to build decks in this format. And Old School is weird because it plays a lot of the most powerful cards and a lot of the, like, most not powerful cards on the reserve list. You're looking at cards like Juzam Jin, Thunder Spirit, Preacher. You know, these cards are not extreme powerful reserve list cards. And some of them aren't even that expensive yet. But they see play in this format, like Guardian Beast, Fork, even a little bit. But so these are all reserveless cards that see play in Old School, exclusively almost. No other format is looking for Thunder Spirit, you know. And it does push up some of those cards because they're needed in playsets, and they're just so rare. You know, Arabian Nights, Antiquities, Legends, like the cards are just so in such short supply that if somebody needs a playset of Serendib Jinns, or they need a playset of Juzam Jinns, it's just the price is going to go crazy. Juzam Jinn is actually one of the cards that I want to pick up at some point, so, you know, if anybody has a Juzam Jinn, hit me up. But yeah, so what do you think? Which of these formats do you play? Are there any of them that are a little bit cost prohibitive to you? Let me know in the comments. I'm interested to hear what you have to say. Have a good day.